Good evening, brothers and sisters. Welcome to our final day of our Lenten retreat, our entrance hymn, Return to the Lord, number 83.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Welcome to our celebration, brothers and sisters. Today's Mass is offered for healing for Frederick Pope, and also in thanksgiving for this week, for the intention of all of you who took part in the retreat, who came every evening. We offer this Mass in a special way for your intentions as well. As we begin, let us pause for a moment to acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that purifying us by the sacred practice of penance, you may lead us in sincerity of heart to attain the holy things to come. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. Israel loved Joseph more than all his other sons, for he was the son of his old age, and he had a coat with long sleeves made for him. But his brothers, seeing how his father loved him more than all his other sons, came to hate him so much that they could not say a civil word to him. His brothers went to pasture their father's flock at Shechem. Then Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers with the flock at Shechem? Come, I am going to send you to them." So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him in the distance, and before he reached them, they made a plot among themselves to put him to death. "Here comes the man of dreams," they said to one another. "Come on, let us kill him and throw him into some well. We can say that a wild beast devoured him. Then we shall see what becomes of his dreams." But Reuben heard, and he saved him from their violence. "We must not take his life," he said. "Shed no blood," said Reuben to them. "Throw him into this well in the wilderness, but do not lay violent hands on him." Intending to save him from them, and to restore him to his father. So when Joseph reached his brothers, they pulled off his coat, the coat with long sleeves that he was wearing, and catching hold of him, they threw him into the well, an empty well with no water in it. They then sat down to eat. Looking up, they saw a group of Ishmaelites who were coming from Gilead. Their camels, laden with gum, tragacanth, balsam, and resin, which they were taking down into Egypt. Then Judah said to his brothers, "What do we gain by killing our brother and covering up his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, but let us not do any harm to him. After all, he is our brother and our own flesh." His brothers agreed. Now some Midianite merchants were passing, and they drew Joseph up out of the well. They sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 silver pieces, and these men took Joseph to Egypt. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Remember the wonders the Lord has done. God called on a famine on the land. He broke the staff that supported them. He had sent a man before them, Joseph, sold as a slave. His feet were put in chains. His neck was bound with iron, until what he said came to pass, and the Lord's word proved him true. Then the king sent and released him. The ruler of the people set him free, making him master of his house and ruler of all he possessed. Much that he gave his only son. Everyone who believes in him has eternal life.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory be to you, Lord.
Jesus said to the chief priests and the elders of the people, "Listen to another parable. There was a man, a landowner, who planted a vineyard. He fenced it round, dug a wine press in it, and built a tower. Then he leased it to tenants and went abroad. When vintage time drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his servants, thrashed one, killed another, and stoned a third. Next, he sent some more servants, this time a larger number, and he dealt with them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them. 'They will respect my son,' he said. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to each other, 'This is the heir. Come on, let us kill him and take over his inheritance.' So they seized him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They answered, "He will bring those wretches to a wretched end and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will deliver the produce to him when the season arrives." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? It was the stone rejected by the builders that became the keystone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is wonderful to see. I tell you then that the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a people who will produce its fruit." When they heard his parables, the chief priests and the scribes realized he was speaking about them. But though they would have liked to arrest him, they were afraid of the crowds, who looked on him as a prophet. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good evening, brothers and sisters in Christ. It is an evening of mixed feelings. I am very sad to leave, and I'm very happy having spent this week with you. But I'm sad that it has come to an end. It has come to an end so quickly. And I want to take this opportunity to say a special thanks to Father Brent and for Deacon Charles, who welcomed me into their parish and made me feel at home. And I also want to thank all of you, those of you who were present during the 5 days, and for your support and for your encouragement and for your nice words kind words of advice, and your hospitality. Your hospitality was certainly much better than the tenants who got the vineyard and the press, because you made me feel very much welcome. Today is our last day, and I saved the best for last. Remember that story in Cana when the wine was running out? Well, today the wine is running out, but we hopefully saved the best for last. During this week, I spoke that prayer, which was our theme for the week, prayer was a tool of communication given to us by God so that we will renew, build up, enhance our relationship with God. That prayer enables us to communicate, as in all loving relationships, with God. That in our lives, we can't build a relationship without communication. And communication is vital. And yesterday we heard that men are relational beings, that God said it is not good for man to be alone, and therefore let me give him a helpmate. And we therefore saw that it was so important for us to be able to communicate with God, for us to be able to have a relationship with God. And on the final day, the most powerful means of communication is presented, which is the Mass. The Mass allows us, like none of the other 13 prayers that we delved in over the week, the Mass is the summit of all. Pope Benedict, who I took most of today's homily from, said that the Mass is the source and summit of Christian life. That the Mass allows us to communicate with God in a way that none of the other prayers that we dealt with during this week allows us to. And therefore, it was fit and proper that Father should have the last day of the retreat as a Mass, because the Mass is a summit. And everything we learned during this week, we bring it together today in the Mass. The Mass is powerful because, unlike the other prayers that we learned this week, we are communicating with someone who is present, but who is present spiritually. So when all the prayers that we were doing, we were communicating with the Trinity, but we were communicating with the Trinity in a spiritual way. In the Mass, unlike all of those other prayers, we communicate with a physical presence, and that's so powerful. My son, Kirk, had a relationship with his now wife for about 4 years, and they communicated via Zoom, and they communicated online. And yet, after 4 years of communicating online, they finally eventually came together to get married. And that communication was a lot more intimate and powerful than that communication online. By the way, I like to tell stories. God always has a story for us. And my son actually was studying in Barbados. And his wife now was also studying in Barbados. And they were studying, doing law at Cave Hill, and she was doing something on law. And he would see her and she would see him off and on, but they really would not get together. And on the last day in Barbados, the following day he was going to fly out of Barbados, On the last day, they had a little party. And the last song of that party was The Last Dance. And Kirk said he looked across the room and he saw this girl. She is his wife today. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that powerful? That God so loves things, that makes things and brings love together into the world. And therefore, we also see this. The Mass, unlike any other prayer, makes Jesus present. Jesus, and I want to read Pope Benedict's words. He stressed that the Eucharist is not merely a symbolic gesture, but the true presence of Christ, body, blood, soul, and divinity. And it is a love relationship that is finally culminated in a physical presence. My son Kirk met this girl on the last day. And afterwards, they communicated online. But eventually, they had a physical presence with each other. And during this week, we have been communicating with God online, so to speak, spiritually. And we have learned a lot of techniques. We have learned Zoom, but we also learned WhatsApp and all sorts of other ways of communicating with God. But today, in the Mass, we communicate with God physically, in a physical presence. And there can be no greater intimacy than physicality. Therefore, we thank our Lord God Jesus Christ. We thank God the Father. We thank the Trinity. Because we learned this week that in our love relationship with God, God is the protagonist. He is the quarter. We are the respondents. We are like Kirk's wife. We respond to God's courting. And God, after courting for so many millennia, decided that we have to bring this relationship to a closer proximity. And God sent his son physically into the world. And like in today's gospel, the tenants took the son and beat him up, gave him a passion, crucified him. But on the last day, on the third day, he rose again. And through that resurrection, brings us to a physicality that was not possible before. Today, we culminate our retreat with a way of communicating our love to God through a physical presence of Him. Pope Benedict says that's the purpose of sacraments. Sacraments provide gestures and symbols, but in the Mass, this sacrament is the actual presence. We see it in the form of the host, in the precious blood, but physically, Jesus is there. And in that physicality, we can connect in a way that we couldn't connect with the other prayers. I believe, just like my son, on the online communication, all the prayers that we said this week, today is the day where the relationship is a physical relationship. And we thank God for the Mass. We thank God that Jesus Christ, through his death and resurrection, has given us his body physically in the Mass. And therefore, there can be no deeper communication of love than the Mass. The Mass and the sacraments, the other sacraments, go even further All the prayers do it, but the Mass does it more than anyone, and I therefore did not reveal it until today, the topic of grace. Because in a love relationship, as we heard, there is the immensity of God and the finiteness of man. And one of the things of a love relationship with something that is so vast and something that is so minuscule is that we don't have the power, we don't have the capability of loving God. And God, through the sacraments and through the prayers, but more through the sacraments and mostly through the Mass, gives us grace. And grace is an empowerment for us to be able to love God. How wonderful that is. That God does not even just want to have a loving relationship with us, but he gives us the power to be able to love him. Very often in life, we would like to love more, but in the relationships, we lack the capacity to love. During this week, we saw and we reflected that each person is broken. Each person comes to a love relationship not whole. And I shared on the first night that in my on our original marriage encounter weekend, we were told that a couple, through the sacrament of marriage, are given the capacity to heal. And we said that that capacity to heal is love. And that love is a grace from God. And that sacrament of marriage not only joins two people, but actually empowers them to be able to love. And so in the Mass, more than that, in the Mass, God, the Trinity, reaches out to love us physically, but goes even more than that, gives us the grace to respond to that love call. We therefore, Pope Benedict says it here, he said, we should cultivate, because this is so great, we should cultivate a spirit of reverence or an attentiveness in the Mass. Cultivate a spirit of reverence or an attentiveness. Because it is such a wonderful gesture of love that Jesus, that God himself, God the Father, sent his Son into the world, as in today's gospel, to be crucified by these people, by the tenants. True, there can be no greater love than that. Jesus said it himself. He said, which man will lay down his life? Probably you would lay down your life for a good person. But while we were unworthy, God sent his Son to die for us, to be able for us to enjoy a Mass today. And through that Mass gives us the grace to respond to God's love. Earlier this week, we gave a quotation from Philippians that what is man that God would so love him to do this? The immensity of God, who has created the universe, should stoop so low to want to fall in love with us. And not just fall in love with us, but give us the grace to love him back. Brothers and sisters, the Mass and the grace of the Mass is the ultimate summit and source of all our prayers that we've learned this week. All of our prayers this week are courting prayers. We're walking holding hands. Today, is the nuptial wedding. The Mass brings it to its culmination. The Mass, there is no more intimacy than this, that in the host we actually take the body and blood, soul and divinity of our Lord, of the Trinity, into ourselves. And through that gain the grace to be able to respond in love. Brothers and sisters, this week we have had a wonderful experience. We have had wonderful ways of interacting and understanding prayer, understanding different ways of communicating with God, courting prayers. But today we bring our relationship to the marriage feast of the Lamb. Today we culminate the courting by getting married. Today we are marrying the Lamb. Today our love relationship is consummated. And we thank God for such a powerful gesture of love. So often we come to Mass and we just go through the rudiments. But today, because we've been prepared for the whole week, I dare say that most of us, after this week of reflecting on prayer, we are in a different state. And we are ready to consummate this marriage that we have been working towards for the whole week. We thank God for His grace. We ask Him to give us, to use again, the awe, reverence, and attentiveness so that we can celebrate our consummation of our relationship today through the Blessed Sacrament of the Mass. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Please stand as we offer our prayers to our Heavenly Father, who we know loves us tenderly.
Loving and gracious God, we turn to you tonight asking that you look after your church. Continue to pour out your grace upon her. Continue to bless her, that we may grow ever so much closer to you. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We thank you, O God, for the gift of family. We ask your blessings upon each and every family in this church, in this community, in our society, and in this world. We ask, O God, that all families continue to grow in love of you and of each other. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all leaders in our country and in our community. We ask, O God, that all leaders may continue to look to you for guidance, for strength, for courage, so that all the right decisions can be made for the good of your people. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We ask an outpouring on all priests, deacons, bishops. We ask, O God, that in our lives we may continue to draw ever so much closer to you, that we may be able to lead your people and save souls. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We turn to you, O God, remembering those who are sick, those who are suffering, those who are struggling in any way. May all that we do in our life continue to be able to make your presence known to them, and help us especially to remember those who have no one to pray for them. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We now come to you, O God, with our own personal intentions as we bring it to you from the silence of our hearts. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray in a special way for healing for Frederick Pope and for all of us gathered here who journeyed over this week. We pray that God will give us the graces that we need, the things that we need in our lives. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We make these prayers and all of our prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our collection hymn, You Are God, Mighty and True, number 23.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May your merciful grace prepare your servants, O God, for the worthy celebration of these mysteries, and lead them to it by a devout way of life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For you have given your children a sacred time for the renewing and purifying of their hearts, that freed from disordered affections, they may so deal with the things of this passing world as to hold rather to the things that eternally endure. And so with all the angels and saints we praise you, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, you may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Jason, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy you may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as you await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Our communion hymn, "The Lord is My Shepherd," number 41. Number 44.
Let us pray. Having received this pledge of eternal salvation, we pray, O Lord, that we may set our course so well as to attain the redemption you promise, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Father Brent, Deacons Charles and Ben Gucci, brothers and sisters, good evening. Now we have come to the end of a most spiritual week. And as is customary in Bugmalatris, we will be saying thanks to Deacon Ben Gucci. Deacon, I want to let you know that as a former member of the teaching fraternity, you have passed the test. Right? I'm saying that because we know that unless the children have learned, you have not taught. And you have done very well. So in terms of the marks, we have fair, we have good, and we have excellent. Where do we place Deacon? Excellent. Okay. Because Deacon, you have taught us that prayer should lead to transformation. Very, very important. Prayer should lead to transformation. Prayer penetrates the barriers that we put in our lives. You have taught us the different forms of prayer. Prayer as a tool which God gives us to communicate with Him. The most difficult one that we have to live with is that forgiveness. That one hard, okay? Right? So we have enjoyed your stories, but today you reminded us that the Mass is that ultimate summit of all our prayers. For this week, when you have demonstrated through your wife Sandy and yourself that the prayer of meditation and examine, we thank you very much. And so I invite you to please come forward so that we can, just as how we have a physical presence in the Mass, we are giving you a physical thank you.
Yes, so Deacon, on behalf of the Carmelite friars who minister here, and Deacon Charles and myself, you know, thank you very much. I was boasting that, you know, God put everything in alignment. Because when we decided we are having the topic of prayer, and I said, well, of course, Deacon Ben Gucci is well known on this topic. You have a blog and so on, right? So please, you all can follow him online. And then, a few days after, guess what? Pope Francis announced the year, that the year will be the year on prayer. I say, everything aligned. You see how powerful we are? We influence Pope Francis as well. Anyway, it was the Holy Spirit. So we thank you very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Please stand and bow your heads and pray for God's blessings. Grant your people, O Lord, we pray, health of mind and body, that by constancy in good deeds, they may always merit the defense of your protection. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you. Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass is ended. Go in peace, glorifying our Lord by your lives and saying your prayers.
Or a session of Him, Blessed Assurance 192.